Okay. Hi, I'm Michael Lin. I'm a game designer and researcher. So simulator sickness is a series of motion sickness-like symptoms that people experience when they're engaging with 3D environments, simulated 3D environments. So we have symptoms like nausea, dizziness, ocular motor discomfort, typically. Okay, so it's important to make a distinction here between motion sickness and simulator sickness. The difference, aside from some difference in symptoms, is that motion sickness is experienced when people, requires that people experiencing it have stimulation of their vestibular system, which governs their balance, and so they have to actually be moving. But simulator sickness doesn't have that requirement. So for example, if you're reading in a car would be example motion sickness, whereas sitting still and perceiving motion is simulator sickness. And the reason this is important is because people tend to mix up the two. And it's important because what this research is intended to address is simulated 3D environments. So like when playing games. So playing a game like Halo or Mirror's Edge constitutes simulator sickness, whereas like people like playing Candy Crush on like the T but getting sick from that isn't sort of what's being covered here. It's for the purpose of the clarification. So there's been some research on simulator sickness for some time. The research I found goes as far back as the 1980s. But most of it deals with dynamic simulations, so stuff like vehicle simulators for the military and theme park rides, but there hasn't been a whole lot of it addressing games specifically. Some of the research I found, let me see, so there's a 1993 study that found that Chinese people who experienced sim sickness had a higher rate and severity than people of African American or European American descent. 1994 study said that found that females, female-identified people experience it at a higher rate than men at the double the severity score, which is a function of frequency and symptom severity. And a 2012 study found that between studying people of different ages, found that elderly people experience sensitiveness at a rate of 29%, for young people, 7%. So what that says demographically for us is that an older Chinese woman would be more likely to experience sensitiveness more so than like a young white male, for instance, which sort of gives you an idea of like what that suggests for the demographics of the industry and how that's being shaped in terms of who's playing games and who's making games. There's also been a lot of research in the past few years on head-mounted displays with the Oculus Rift. If anyone would like a copy of my sources, if you want to do any research for yourself, I'll have a contact slide at the end of the presentation. Copy down my email or come up and get a business card, and you know, I'd be happy to distribute any of the research to you. So looking specifically at sim sickness in games, as I mentioned, it tends to do with 3D environments. Games tend to be, cost sensitive, tend to be dynamic, like Mirror's Edge, have fairly rotating cameras, like Journey. And so like when people sit down for these experiences, they'll tend to start to feel sick. So all the people in this room, by show of hands, how many of you have ever experienced sim sickness when playing games? Okay. How many of that has been in like racing or driving games? Flying games? Third person games. Any of you have felt sick playing third person games? In first person games?
Yes.
And for any of you who's tried, who's felt sick playing the Oculus Rift? Of the people that have felt sick, however many of you, how many of you have ever cut a gameplay session short because you felt sick? Okay. How many of you have ever had to avoid a game that you wanted to play but couldn't because you felt sick? Or thought you might feel sick? And how many of you have ever made a purchasing decision, like avoided buying a game because you were worried about making people sick? Okay. So I hope that sort of makes some just a suggestion as to why simulation research is important for the purposes of the industry. I know that there's not a lot of you, but would any of you be wanting to give examples of games that like affected you specifically or that you've had to stop playing or avoid playing because of sim sickness?
I couldn't play it.
Okay.
I was demoing like Oculus Rift, and at the end with the most emotions thing I've ever been.
Yeah, and regardless, I mean, technology is important in games, obviously, it's been more of a problem.
Yeah, the roller coaster simulator or something like that.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay, awesome. So that, well, it's not awesome, it's terrible. You know what I mean? Okay, so this brings me to my research that I did from a master's thesis. It's called, I called it Mimetic Labs. So it's it was a two-part research study consisting of an online survey and in-person playtest. It's intended to gather a broad spectrum of data regarding simsickness to try and help developers get a sense for who's being affected by simsickness and what they might be able to do about it. And there's also a secondary goal of helping people who are affected by simsickness, either players or developers, sort of work or play around simsickness so they can function better in relation to games. So the first part of my research was a survey, which I called the DSG survey. Called something I've called that. It's a brief online survey on demographic factors, age, race, and gender, among others. Motion sickness background, so like under what circumstances people do feel sick outside of games, and gaming background. What kind of games people play, what kind of games make them sick, what symptomology they feel, and how they respond to those. And so I distributed this online for a few months back in the spring and early summer. And got a total of 90 respondents, a total of valid respondents out of the target of 51. So I divided the people that responded to this survey into two categories based on their responses to this question: have you ever begun to feel sick while playing a video game? People who responded yes frequently or yes occasionally, which is designated sim sickness susceptible, and people who responded never, and is designated sim sickness non-susceptible, which I had trouble identifying good abbreviations for. So this, so these next few slides are some of the more conclusive results from the survey data. This you see here is the gender distribution of people who took the survey. About a two-thirds split between susceptible and non-susceptible. As you can see here, non-susceptible people were overwhelmingly male, whereas susceptible people were majority female, and all the non-binary people fit in this category as well. Which sort of this corroborates the existing research suggesting that there's a gender correlation with games. And there's also, I don't know if anyone saw, there's an article a few months back called "Is the Oculus Rift Sexist?" That talked about how trans individuals undergoing hormone treatment would find that their depth cues and visual perception changed as a result of their hormone balance, which I thought, which suggests a sort of underlying biological motivation for this difference. I had a question that asked people when they last felt sick playing a video game. What symptoms did they notice first? Half the people, this question was given to people who were sensitive and susceptible. Half the respondents said nausea was a symptom that they noticed first, with headache and dizziness as a distinct second and third, which makes sense. These are the ones that tend to be most noticeable simply because they tend to cause a headache and answer the end of your session. This isn't an exclusive list of symptoms, but these are the ones that are sort of the most prominent. No one responded to sleepiness, which I guess makes sense because if you're playing a game and you feel sleepy, you tend not to attribute it to the fact that you're playing a game, just if you're playing well at 4 in the morning. This one looks at the correlation between motion sickness susceptibility and sim sickness susceptibility. It asks them people to look at a variety of circumstances under which they might feel motion or sim sick. Driving, writing, reading in the car, writing or reading in a plane. I didn't expect a lot of pilots to respond, so I did put the fly in a plane. And writing a theme park ride, which has sort of like a wide variety of possible circumstances. And as you can see, the susceptible people in almost all categories, except for theme park rides, responded at more than double the rate of people, of non-susceptible people, that they would feel sick under these circumstances, which suggests that motion sickness vulnerability is a possible good predictor of sim sickness vulnerability. I even had one person that say that they would feel sick when driving a car, so I don't know how they got to the test.
when you're hungover.
That's entirely fun. So this question asked what kind of games generally make people feel sick. First person games were almost universal among people who were susceptible. 48 out of 50 people said that first person games made them feel sick. In addition, some of the people who left first-person games blank mentioned in the other section that specific first-person games that make people sick, like Call of Duty or Portal. There's also about a third of the people said that third-person games made them feel sick. And just under a fifth each of racing and driving games and flight simulator games. And people responded other either had like, specific games that made them feel sick or wanted to specify specific circumstances like playing on a vehicle or using special hardware like the Oculus. There's also a small number of people, I think on the order of between 5 and 10%, who didn't get sick with first-person games, but did get sick with other types of games. So since it isn't exclusively a first-person problem. But so these next couple of slides look at the results for video sim-sickness tolerance. People who were susceptible were given this question, asked them how long it took them to feel sick after starting to play a game. A plurality of people said between 10 and 30 minutes is the time to feel sick, with about an even split on either side of that threshold. And after people started to feel sick, how long did it take them to stop playing? And overwhelmingly, the majority had stopped playing after about a few minutes. Some people didn't let the feelings of sickness affect the time it took them to play, either because their symptoms were too mild or it was too engaging. Some people had symptoms so severe that they had to stop immediately. But overall, about after a few minutes, in case anyone wants to do research on their own, just get a sense for how long you can subject people to games before they decide to want to go away. Okay, and this, I also had a battery of questions asking people what they did before, during, and after gameplay to alleviate some feelings of sickness. This is also stuff that's readily available to you, for those of you who came in. I have a contact info slide at the end of the presentation. If you want to take down my email, I'll come up and get a card, or you can just ask me for information. Email me if you want either a copy of my sources and or a copy of these responses for what people did to alleviate their symptoms. So that, you know, if you want to try something out yourself, feel free. Before gameplay, some things that people said they would do to alleviate the feeling of sickness would be make sure the surroundings are well lit and avoid eating heavily before play. During gameplay, people would take frequent visual breaks. They would look away from the screen, stop the screen from moving for a while, and eventually stop playing. And after gameplay, 10 popular themes for what people did to alleviate their symptoms focused on avoiding stimulation. So they would go sit down in a quiet room for a while, lie down in the dark, close their eyes, and just let their visual and visual system reset. Some people with more severe symptoms would take a nap. And also on consumption. So people with not tuberculosis on consuming things. People consume ginger in some form, like candy or tea, stay hydrated, and some people would take drugs of varying degrees of legality to respond to their symptoms. So like Dramamine or Gravol, as it's marketed in Canada, and others. Yes?
I just know one sugar I have is caffeine.
Okay.
It does affect it. You know, it's like, the idea was like, if I get motion sickness, something normally I'd avoid it. Avoid eating, eat dry foods like pretzels, and water. You know, something like that. But it's, I don't know about in video, but I know in physical motion sickness, that's what I did. But I don't know, I haven't tried it with video yet. But.
Okay. Cool. That's great. Thank you. Anyone else just saw the answer at that talking point? Okay. Okay, so the second part of my research was an in-person playtest. I screened people, took a survey, and had them come in for a playtest to play a simple first-person game that I developed, and have them talk aloud while being supervised and video documented about how they were feeling, any symptoms they were experiencing, and how they were responding to it in real time. The game also included metrics to take data on like how they're navigating the game space, like their rotation speed, their directional tendencies, their how frequently they jump straight, whatever. But I found the more interesting data to come from the actual logging in the lab. There's a screenshot of my game. It's actually an open screenshot of my game at Medic Labs. It's a simple hide-and-seek game in a very primitive, regular space like you see here. The objective is to chase that little red cube there. And you get close to it, runs away from you, you have to actively track it, or if you lose it, try and navigate the space to find it again. Does anyone like to try? I mean, Okay. Come on up. So, fair warning, as you might have imagined, this game is has the possibility they can use it. I want to give you this. You can stop at any time. Let me see if I can figure out how to use it. I'll just have you around here.
Okay.
No one sees you. Let's see how it goes.
Oh.
So, have a seat, please. So the way this game would work is that I'd have people come in, sign off on an informed consent form, because this was an IRP approved protocol. And then play the game while I'm watching them and having their screen videotaped and their voice recorded. Is it outside the official setting parameters? Hey. So while you're playing, I'd like you to talk a lot about how you're feeling. I'm myself nervous, and people are watching you. And sort of as you can see, oh, if anyone starts to feel sick, please take your look away. So as you can see, you know, it's a navigable space, it's pretty regular, there's sort of nucleation points for all sorts of interesting navigation, like moving through, like forward through space and having things move past you in depth, strafing if you want to look like scan the environment look for things, and hurdles to possibly jump. So you would play this game, talk a lot about it, they were free to stop at any time that they wanted because you know, I can't compel people to play a game, and for purposes of their welfare, it's important to sort of make sure that they understand fully like what risks they're taking on when they're taking part in this experience. Hard stop. There's a hard stop after 20 minutes, and then afterwards there'd be there'd be post-test survey. To talk about like how severe the symptoms were and what their sort of primary symptom was.
What size screen were you doing it with?
17-inch screen.
17. Mm-hmm.
This is on a personal computer with a mouse and keyboard setup.
So do you think you get better results? I mean, worse results with a larger screen?
It depends because
visual.
Visual envelopment.
Yeah.
Some of the HMD research I found suggests that like having peripheral vision occluded tends to worsen symptoms.
Right.
Whether or not actually having stuff moving in that space or having it blocked off is worse, it's hard to say.
I think this for you is wall hacking.
So was this designed intentionally to try to get people sick?
Yes and no.
The motion of the camera is very twitchy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's not smooth at all. So some aspects of it are intended to sort of encourage sickness, but at the same time, it's not built to be like this wacky, crazy,
right.
Like Alice in Wonderland type LSD experience to make people super sick. So like you see here, so like some examples of things that we've done to like make people sick is like encouraging movement and sort of all the major axes. And to feel less sick is like having clear shape and color differences between all objects. This is also for usability, so like people with different levels of visual ability or acuity can also play just effectively. Textures, color, shapes, and also having like a crosshair in the middle of the screen tends to be like a focus object for people. And so like I said, a lot of the useful results for this part of the research came from having people talk to me about their experiences. And some people said that the temperature of the room made a difference, the color palette in the game made a difference for them, like having a plush helps or having a cool room helped them. Like I mentioned, having a crosshair in the middle of the screen tends to help people. Hard lines tends to reduce alleviate symptoms when people are playing games. Like if you had an outdoor space, make lines clearer, have a sharp horizon. the featureless voids tend to be what make people feel sick much more readily. They don't have a better way to orient themselves. Yeah. You can stop whenever you're. Yeah, you're okay. Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Okay, I guess you don't need this guy.
Like that?
Fine. What's Alt and 4 on the Mac?
Thank you.
Ah, thank you. So after people take the test, they have the general recovery area, like this is part of my protocol. They have refreshments, which include ginger ale and ginger teas. This is all based on sort of what people said either before testing or in response to the survey. Have a quiet checklist, a resting area for them to sit in, and if possible or necessary, have them find a different means of like avoid having them feel symptoms while like driving home. So either by having them sit for a long time and then to subside, or simply like find it on the way home. So highlights, this is just sort of more results from the data, people tended to feel more sick and they had to rotate and translate at the same time, or like can't like rotate on through wide arcs, like more than like 90 or 120 degrees, depending on the individual. And they rotate and move. As you saw, like the twitchy controls didn't like wasn't bad for some people. Having focused objects, having a clear sense of relative position of objects, tend to help having space be regular, as you saw. And for some one, at least one subject, strafing tend to feel better than having stuff really past them in space. This is more of the same point I just told you, like these are some actionable items for if you're developing as a first person game or a three-dimensional game. Having levels that encourage like or allow for single access movements rather than sort of like requiring people to turn and spin and jump and slide at the same time. And having custom possible characters to help. For shooters, this usually means like having toggle camera bob, or like adjustable field of view, among other things. So in future research, things that would either like anyone else wants to do it, boosting production quality would be nice, either having like sort of more complex games. And so like you saw the game that I made, it's pretty general in terms of like shape primitives and such. Just for a good reason, I'll talk about later, but right short on time. Large sample sizes for anything involving like research is obviously helpful. And controlled A/B testing would be nice. This is pretty general, but being able to isolate test specific variables is easier said than done, but still like possible room for interesting research, stuff like color balance, room temperature. The setup, either console or like a television set versus like a screen right in front of you versus like a mobile device, that kind of thing, right? And obviously HMD has lots of good features there as well. Any questions? I want to leave you with questions. Yes?
Do you get some sickness, or how did you end up sort of...
I don't. I have a lot of friends, like most friends, who experience sickness, and they're really avid gamers. And also people around them, so like they find that they're not able to play the games that they want to because they feel sick. Also, I have friends who are game developers who want to make games, but like have their testing or development like options limited because they feel sick, which was another reason for me. And like also from my time here at MIT, like my mentor here really instilled in me like sort of emphasizing the importance of usability and accessibility, which is why I wanted to do this research. Yes.
During your research, how many people did you record? How many people are wearing glasses?
I didn't. I had the results from the survey, what kind of visual system that they have, whether they use contacts or nearsighted, farsighted, that kind of thing, but I didn't analyze any of those since the presentation. Yes?
For the field of vision, did you notice any correlation with more or less motion sickness?
I didn't. Originally I wanted to make the field of view customizable for my game, but like that would be kind of like hard to do in terms of like, because it's such a short playtime period, and like, changing it sort of dynamically on them, which sort of like model some of the other results I was looking at. Some people have said, just like from researching online forums and stuff, that like depending on the game, like default field of view is set to one thing, but they change it to another, it'll tend to make them feel sick. That's definitely something for research for the top field of view effects play for different players too, because Male identified and female identified people and non-identified had just different natural or inherent fields of view, which can change based on like their visual system and like how they live like just through life. So that's definitely something to be looked at further. Yeah.
Do you know if vertical sync or lack thereof would affect results at all?
I don't know. I honestly don't. It's definitely something I can look at.
Does any of your research apply to like the Oculus and that sort of systems, or is this purely like a 3D game?
That's a good question.
Just on a computer.
Yeah. So for purposes of this research, I wanted to focus primarily on computers simply because it would help them be more generalizable. In the sense that people who tend to feel sick playing the Oculus don't necessarily feel sick playing games at home, which is a more sort of widespread sort of usage. Whereas people who feel sick playing at home will almost certainly feel sick playing the Oculus. So by sort of focusing on that group with sort of more the less sensitive visual system, would sort of hopefully the results would apply sort of more broadly. But like for future research, that definitely would be nice to sort of focus on different specific usage modes.
Have you seen anything of a way of providing therapy over motion sickness through video games?
I feel like part of it's partly therapeutic because like a lot of individuals sort of like how they all got this from dealing with sickness. It's also partly a development, like development side issue, I think. So like designing games in such a way to sort of accommodate people who feel sick, especially for independent or student developers who don't always have the resources to like have a large group of people come in and test and sort of beta test their game and make sure like sickness is less an issue for everybody. That's also sort of the purpose of the demographic research, is this pinpoint like people who are most affected by it, so that if you want to have testers come in specifically that are most likely going to like provide a sim sickness data point for them, that's something we look at.
Okay.
One last question, I guess.
Is there any research being done on how audio design affects motion sickness?
That's a good question. I didn't find any, but that doesn't mean it doesn't exist. If you want, I can, again, if you want, you can come up to or take down my email address and get in touch with me, and I'll send out my bibl update to anyone who wants it, so they can sort of get a starting point if you want to do more research on your own. Thanks, everybody.